Welcome to my talk. I'm Ryo, and going to talk about updatable encryption. In this work, we propose a new definition for updatable encryption. We call it backward leak unidirectional key updates. Then we show that backward leak unidirectional key updates are strictly no longer than the existing unidirectional key updates. We also propose two secure constructions of updatable encryption. First, I review what is updatable encryption. Let's consider the following scenario. I saved her encrypted data on a cloud server. Her computer is attacked and her secret key is leaked. To protect her data, she generates a new secret key. She should not reveal the secret key to the cloud server, so she downloads all encrypted data from the server, decrypts them by the new secret key again, and uploads them to the server. This incurs significant efficiency loss. To resolve this issue, we use updatable encryption. In updatable encryption, we can periodically update a secret key and ciphertext. An updatable encryption scheme has key generation, encryption, and decryption algorithms as a standard encryption scheme, and has two additional algorithms. One is the token generation algorithm. We can generate an update token from two secret keys. In this talk, we focus on ciphertext independent updates, where we do not need a ciphertext for generating a token. The other one is an update algorithm. We can convert a ciphertext under an old key into one under a new key by using an update token. If Alice uses updatable encryption in the scenario that I explained first, she generates a new key and an update token. Then she passes the token to the server, and the server can directly update all ciphertext without using Alice's secret key. One issue is whether a token leaks information about secret keys or not, since a token is generated from two secret keys. In previous works, there are three categories for key updates. The first one is the bidirectional key update. We can infer a secret key from both directions via a token. That is, we can infer a new key from a token and an old key, and vice versa. The second one is the unidirectional key update. We can infer a new key from a token and an old key. However, we cannot infer an old key from a token and a new key. The last one is the non-directional key update. We cannot infer keys from a token. All previous updatable encryption schemes have a bidirectional key update. This is not desirable since such token leak more information about secret keys. Another issue is whether a token allows downgrading ciphertext or not. There are two types of updating. One is a bidirectional ciphertext update, where we can both update a ciphertext and downgrade a ciphertext and a new key into a ciphertext and an old key. The other one is the unidirectional ciphertext update, where we can only update a ciphertext. The unidirectional ciphertext update is more desirable since a token gives less information to adversaries. However, all previous updatable encryption schemes have bidirectional key updates. A simple example of updatable encryption is as follows. A secret key is an element in ZP. A token is x sub e plus 1 over x sub e, where x sub e plus 1 is a new key. A ciphertext is an Elgamal-like ciphertext. We can update a ciphertext by using the token since x sub e is cancelled out. It is easy to see that this example is a bidirectional key update and bidirectional ciphertext update. The type of key and ciphertext updates affects trivial winning conditions in security games of updatable encryption. Let's see an example. In the table, each number denotes a time period called epoch. In UE security, we consider secret key corruption and token corruption. In the corrupted key law, X mark means the secret key is not leaked, and the check mark means it is leaked. In the corrupted token law, X mark means the token is not leaked, and the check mark means it is leaked. In the bidirectional key update setting, we can infer the secret keys of the second, third, and fourth epochs, since we can infer from both directions. In the unidirectional key update setting, we can infer the secret keys of second and third epochs. However, we cannot infer the fourth secret key since we cannot infer in the backward direction in this setting. If adversaries obtain a secret key that they want to attack, they can trivially break the security of encryption. So, the bidirectional key update triggers more trivial winning conditions than the unidirectional key update. This means the security in the unidirectional key setting seems to be stronger than the security in the bidirectional setting. However, Jan proves that the security in the bidirectional key update setting is equivalent to the security in the unidirectional key update setting. This is surprising since the direction of updatable encryption does not matter much. However, here is a question. Why do we consider the unidirectional key update where key inference is the forward direction? We can consider another unidirectional key update variant where a key inference is the backward direction. That is, we can infer an old key from a token and a new key, but cannot in the opposite direction. This is a very natural setting. To distinguish two types of unidirectional key updates, we call the previous unidirectional key updates forward leak unidirectional key updates. Let's see the backward leak unidirectional key updates are preferable to the forward leak one. Here, we assume that the ciphertext update is unidirectional. Suppose that the middle secret key is leaked. Then, in the forward leak setting, we can get the newest secret key via token. In this case, even if we securely delete all the ciphertext, we cannot protect the newest ciphertext and updating ciphertext does not help us since the newest key is inferred. In the backward leak setting, we can get the oldest secret key via token. In this case, if we securely deleted all the ciphertext, we can protect the newest key and the ciphertext. Note that I assume that the ciphertext update is unidirectional. Later, I argued that unidirectional ciphertext updates could be standard in the backward leak unidirectional setting. This fits the spirit of updatable encryption. In this work, we introduced the definition of backward leak unidirectional key updates, as I explained so far. Surprisingly, or unsurprisingly, we also showed that the backward leak unidirectional key updates are strictly stronger than the forward leak unidirectional key updates. This is in sharp contrast to Jahn's equivalence theorem. More concretely, we showed that existing secure UE schemes in the forward leak unidirectional key update setting are not secure in the backward leak unidirectional key setting. We present two updatable encryption schemes. One is secure in the backward leak unidirectional setting under the learning with errors assumptions. The other one is secure in the no-directional setting and based on indistinguishability obfuscation and one-way functions. This solves the open problem posed by Jahn at Asia Crypto 2020. This is the comparison with previous schemes. All known schemes are secure in the bidirectional key update setting and the bidirectional ciphertext update setting. By Jahn's equivalence theorem, these schemes are secure in the forward leak unidirectional key update setting. We propose the first secure schemes in the backward leak unidirectional and the no-directional key update setting. A concurrent and independent work by Slermaning and Strix presents a secure scheme in the no-directional key update setting. However, the size of secret key and ciphertext depends on the total number of updates. In previous and our schemes, the size of secret key and ciphertext is constant. Let's see the backward leak unidirectional key updates are strictly stronger than the forward leak one. First, we see a simple but crucial observation here. UE needs the power of public key encryption. All existing UE schemes need PKE power since they rely on concrete assumptions that imply PKE. In addition, Almaty, Montgomery, and Patronabis prove that UE implies PKE. So we can assume a UE key consists of the secret key and public key parts. A token is generated from two keys. Here, an old secret key is necessary. Otherwise, the token does not have the power of converting an old ciphertext into a new one. How about a new secret key? In fact, we do not need the secret key part of the new key. Let's consider a token generated from an old secret key and the public key part of a new key. This token potentially converts an old ciphertext into a new one since the public key part of the new key is sufficient for encryption. In addition, the token does not have information about SK sub E plus 1 beyond the PK sub E plus 1. So, the token could be backwardly unidirectional and could not be used to downgrade a new ciphertext into an old one. In fact, our backwardly unidirectional scheme has this structure. In contrast, a token generated from two secret keys is forwardly and bidirectional. Note that if we use PK sub E, it is not clear whether a token can convert a ciphertext. Now I present a concrete example that is secure in the bidirectional or forwardly unidirectional setting, but not secure in the backwardly unidirectional setting. Jahn's equivalence theorem says that we trigger the trivial winning conditions in the bidirectional setting if and only if we trigger the trivial winning conditions in the forwardly unidirectional setting. We consider the leakage condition in the table. In the bidirectional setting, we can infer the second, third, and fifth secret keys via corrupted tokens. As I show in the table, the first, sixth, and seventh secret keys are protected. In the forward leak setting, we can infer the fifth secret key, but cannot the second and third secret keys. However, we cannot set second and third epochs as a target, since we can convert a ciphertext under second and third keys into one under corrupted keys via tokens. So, as in the bidirectional setting, setting second and third epochs as a target triggers the trivial winning conditions. In the backward leak setting, we can infer the second and third secret keys, but cannot the fifth secret key. Here, we can set fifth epoch as a target, since we cannot convert the ciphertext in the fifth epoch into one or under corrupted keys in the unidirectional ciphertext update setting. Thus, unlike the forward leak unidirectional and bidirectional setting, the fifth epoch does not trigger the trivial winning conditions. This corruption setting shows the separation result. Previous schemes are secure in the bidirectional or forwardly unidirectional setting. In the setting, we cannot set the fifth epoch as a target. However, in the backwardly unidirectional setting, we can set the fifth epoch as a target. Non-secure schemes do not prevent extracting a new secret key from a token and an old key. So it means non-schemes are not secure in the backward leak unidirectional setting. I do not explain security experiments for UE since they are not crucial to understanding the difference of directions in UE. Now, let's see our construction. First, I explain our backwardly unidirectional scheme. The idea is simple. I use fully homomorphic encryption to explain our idea. A token is a ciphertext of an old secret key, SK sub E, and a new public key, PK sub E plus 1. A rectangle denotes encryption under some public key. A ciphertext is simple encryption of a message under PK-sub-E. To update the ciphertext, we encrypt the ciphertext by using the new public key PK-sub-E+1. Then, we homomorphically decrypt the ciphertext under PK-sub-E by using the evaluation algorithm of FHE, and get the ciphertext of M under the new public key PK-sub-E+1. This idea is based on FHE. However, we directly construct our scheme by using the key switching technique. So, we do not rely on FHE in our scheme. The construction idea comes from unidirectional proxy re-encryption based on the LW assumption. The token can be generated from an old secret key and a new public key. So it is easy to see that the token is backward unidirectional. We can also see that our scheme has unidirectional ciphertext updates. If we can downgrade a ciphertext by using a token, we can break the security of the old key without the old secret key. Note that we do not need to use the old secret key to generate a token. Lastly, we see our non-directional scheme. The idea is obfuscating re-encryption circuit. A re-encryption circuit takes an old ciphertext, decrypts it, encrypts the result again, and outputs the re-encrypted ciphertext. A token is an obfuscated re-encryption circuit. In the circuit, the old and new secret keys are hardwired, but they are protected by the security of obfuscation. So this scheme has the non-directional key updates. It is easy to see that this scheme has unidirectional ciphertext updates. In our construction, we cannot use secret key encryption in the black box way since we use indistinguishability obfuscation. We use punctable PRFs as secret key encryption and achieve secure UE. Let me summarize my talk. We propose a new definition for updatable encryption, backward link unidirectional key updates. We show that existing bidirectional key update scheme are not secure in the backward link unidirectional setting. This is in sharp contrast to Jahn's equivalence theorem, which says the security in the bidirectional key update setting is equivalent to the security in the forward link unidirectional setting. We propose two new UE schemes. One is backward link unidirectional scheme from the LW assumption. The other one is non-directional scheme from IO and one-way functions. Both schemes have unidirectional ciphertext updates. Our take-home message is the direction of updatable encryption does matter. That's it. Thank you for watching my talk.